greater works. Jesus told us that. I've seen snippets of these things, but I'm ready to see them all the time. Why? Because, well, first of all, it's fun to see God work.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go ahead and admit that to you right now. It beats, you know, a poking eye with a sharp stick all day long.
Okay.
The other thing is that we have a world full of people that are hurting, and there's no remedy for their hurt except the blood of Jesus.
Okay.
And we got to be able to go out and give it to them. And I'm going to tell you what makes you go more. You know, Josh got all fired up, and I hope he's still fired up. He'll pray for these posts before we get out of here.
Right. Come on.
He knows no shame or no worry. He'll go, he sees an affliction, he attacks it like a bulldog. You know why? Because he's seen God move.
Yeah, right.
When you see God move, it makes you want to go watch him move some more.
Right.
What do we have without that? We've got religion. Ugh. Just boring, God-awful religion. Just come in here every week, do the same thing, do our little Holy Ghost gymnastics, and go home and go right back to work and be the same people we were before we came.
Yeah.
That's not going to work for me anymore.
Come on.
And so I say let it start right here. In 1985, I'm going to guess, Dr. Youngi Cho, he calls himself David now, pastor of the largest church in the world. Right now it's over 1 million people that he is the pastor. And they've got lots of cell groups and all that. But he was praying. He walks every day, his little track, and he prays every day. And somebody asked him the secret of his success. He says, I pray and I obey.
Okay.
There you go. But he said while he was walking, the Lord showed him revival in America.
Okay.
And so he went inside and he pulled out a map of the United States and he closed his eyes and he said, Holy Spirit, leave me. When he put his finger down, where it was going to start was North Alabama. So what do you say we be the first spark in our own first fire kit?
Come on, right? Come on.
And let's just see if we can, as far as I can say, for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Next thing.
Right.
John 14, 11, and 12. This is Jesus speaking. He says, believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. What is he saying? He said, if you don't believe me speaking, then you're going to believe me because of the works. What were the works? Obviously a handbell choir, right? Had a rummage sale, got to believe him for that. No, he said, if you can't believe what I'm saying, I am validating my words as you see the deaf ear open, the blind eye open, and the dead raised from the dead.
Okay.
These works are what identify me with God. Now, if Jesus needed them then, how much more do we need now to be able to demonstrate the power of God? And it got to start with my life first. You know, I got a lot of people running around trying to pray for people. You need to pray for yourself for a little while.
Come on, son.
Because a lot of it is just us trying to push away your observance by my hyper-spirituality. Don't shout me down when I get to preach again. Most assuredly, this is Jesus said, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me. Let's say it together. He who believes in me. The works, tie the words together, that I do, he will do also. And watch this. And greater works than these he will do because I go to the Father. Why did he say that? Because the only place the Holy Spirit was then was in Jesus.
Okay.
It wasn't in him at birth. The most impressive thing Jesus ever did until he was 30 years old is that he made really good furniture. But then he stepped down into the water with John and was baptized with water and to pass the old covenant to the new. And said the Holy Spirit, like a dove, lighted upon him. And Jesus was baptized, filled with the Holy Spirit. After that, he started opening blind eyes, casting out devils. All the works he did was after that moment.
Yeah.
Now, if he'd died before that, he would have gone to heaven. Why? Because, well, you know, he wasn't birthed from Adam. The Holy Spirit was his father, so he didn't have the original sin.
Right, okay.
If anybody's going to heaven, Jesus is, right?
Right.
So why did he do that little gymnastics? Why did he go down in the water? First of all, it would be illegal for him to ask us to do it if he had done it himself. There's a lot of things that pop up. They're fatherless children. They're not led. They're not sent. They just went. And I'm saying for us to be in the family of God. We got to walk down the line and do everything he's telling us to do, because there's an order to this thing. Of course, he's really quick to mess it up if he wants to. He said, greater works than these because I go to the Father. Because when he went to the Father on the day of Pentecost, he sent back the Holy Spirit for everybody else to be little Christs. That's what the word Christian means.
Okay.
They said it to mock us, but it was just as... Jesus is my elder brother. I'm just as much... No, some of you. I'm just as much the Son of God as Jesus. Because he made it that way.
Yeah.
Okay, next page. Some of you look at me hard. Matthew 10:8. This is what Jesus told them. He said, as you go. First step in the greater works is you got to go.
Okay.
Well, how do you know you're going? You're not staying.
Okay.
You're not staying the same. You're not sitting in your comfort zone. You're not avoiding people. You're not you're going to Walmart and you're trying to switch on invisibility. You're looking. You're going for a mission. And he says, as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. I quote Bill Johnson here. He says, somebody came to him and says, I don't know what to do in my life. I really want to be a teacher. Great. When you get that teaching degree, what you need to do is heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, and cast out devils. But I think I want to be a lawyer. Great, be a lawyer. And as you're doing the practice of law, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, and cast out devils. See, every occupation, every drive, every goal has one end goal, that we will raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out devils, and cleanse lepers. That's our job, to preach the kingdom.
All right. That's good.
And that's all you got to do. Everything else is sub to that. So if your job's freaking you out right now, let's get back on a real job and watch what happens.
Yes.
Quit worrying about what's going on and how the bills are going to get paid and start serving him and watch what happens. Next page.
That's good.
Luke 10:1 and then verse number 9. See, I hear all these arguments from people say, well, that command he gave them, that was for the first 12, you know. Because right here he sent 70 more out. Same story. Send them out two by two, and he said, listen, heal the sick when you go.
Okay.
Okie dokie. So there's 70 more, and on the day of Pentecost, there was at least 120. Some people get freaked out that Mary, the mother of Jesus, spoke in tongues. She was there.
Right.
Everybody else did. I don't think she went. No, she did that. Next page. These men, watch this, were all operating under a temporary appointment with borrowed anointing from Jesus. Can you understand that they were raising the dead, healing the sick, cast out devils, and it's just because Jesus said, listen, I'm just going to kind of put this on you. It's got a shelf life, and you're going to just do what I tell you to do when I do it. But you know what? And he didn't say, y'all go out there then and start praying for them to be healed in my name. He didn't even say that.
Yeah.
He said, you heal the sick. Wow. Well, who do you think you are? How much time you got? I'm a born-again child of the Most High God. I'm filled with His Spirit. I'm seated with Him in heavenly places. I'm a joint heir with Jesus. Whatever belongs to Him belongs to me.
Yes.
Does that make me God? No, it doesn't. One look at me tells you that.
Come on. Right.
They were not born again. They were not Spirit-filled. They had no Bible. Nor could they speak in tongues. But they watched demons flee, sickness heal, and the dead raise at their command. How'd they do that? How'd they do it? Next page. It's real simple. They believed.
Yes.
They believed it. They'd seen Jesus do it, and Jesus said, you do it. He said, well, I've got to do it. First, right after I got saved, and like I said, I was rough. I cussed in the first Bible study. I was trying to get their attention. They weren't listening, so I did that. They all looked at me. But somebody dragged me to a revival at one of them funny churches, you know. I got the words on the wall. The minute I walked in, I felt something. I thought, this is great. And my little wife, who wasn't used to all this, I wanted to sit in the front row. I don't be bothered by somebody in front of me. I want to go to the front. That way I can't, if you're staring at me or trying to roll your eyes or whatever, I don't see it. Because I was so hungry. I go to this church and they had a Puerto Rican evangelist about that tall. And his voice was way up here. You know, it's like, And the first night we get there, we walk through the door, and he's walking down through the pews putting hands on everybody, and they're falling out under the table.
Under the table.
Under the chairs. And I thought, that is so cool.
And I thought.
And my wife said, can we get to the car? And so we go the first night, and just, I don't even remember when he preached, but I was just swallowing it up. I was highlighting my Bible. The whole thing was yellow by the time I got done. And so we went back the next night. And so we're doing worship, and I'm a little bit closer to the front because we got there on time. And he calls me out of the crowd. Now I'm kind of like, okay, well, you ain't gonna push me or okay. So I go up there, but on the way up there, my knees are already wobbling. And I got up there, and that little guy put his hand on my head, and I fell out like a sack of wet cement. And I was on the floor. And something happened to me. I'd been baptized in the Holy Spirit, but the power was released in me. And when I got up, here's what I thought. If that guy can do it, why can't I? So back then we had this side of the building, and we had a little Tuesday night Bible study. And we had about 20 people there, I guess, but they were all from denominational churches. And so a bunch of people came forward to pray at the end, and one of the girls was standing there. And I thought, well, let's just see. And I put my hand on her. She fell backwards. Of course, we weren't Pentecostal or nothing, so we didn't know how to catch her. So she went bang, 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 bang on that concrete floor. I thought, she's going to die.
I'm kidding.
She laid there, tears coming out of her eyes, and just because she's in God's presence. And I thought, okay, let's get them all. They all went in. Why? Because I believed it. I didn't think it was me. I thought it was the power of God. It was like, if anybody could do it, I can do it. Because I'm nobody except him,
Yes.
And so what I want to tell you what happens in life is you start out believing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you do some things and they don't work like you want them to. And then you get just a hair skeptical. Next thing you know, you're kind of like, well, I've got too many memories that shoot down my faith.
Yeah.
Because somehow or another, I've traded places with Jesus. And I tell you testimony, you've heard all of my stories. But the point is this, when I trade places with Jesus, I feel like it's my power that's healing this person. When all I'm really doing is just doing what he said.
Mm-hmm.
Because I believe he's going to do the rest.
Right.
It's like when they came up to Jesus' last trip to Jerusalem, he knew he was going to die, and he came out and he saw the fig tree, Mark chapter 11. And so he walked up to the fig tree expecting to find fruit. Why? Because fig trees bear fruit before they bear leaves. And so basically, the fig tree was just like the nation of Israel and just like the church, I reckon, because he said it looks like it's fruitful, it looks like it's got power, but when you go and dig, it's just show. It's just the form of it. And so he cursed the fig tree. Jesus cursed the fig tree. He said, nobody's going to eat fruit on you forever. And the disciples were watching. It's like, they're expecting the fruit, the tree to just burst into flames, I reckon. And it didn't. He's probably tired. It's okay. Yeah, not everybody gets it right. Then the next day, everybody said the next day.
The next day.
They came and the fig tree was withered from the roots of. See, I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes you're praying for stuff and you can't see where the prayer is going. You think it's going there, but it may be going two generations back to kill the root of it.
Come on. Right.
Come on, man. I know what I'm talking about. You don't have to, you're not to steward that and figure it all out with your 4-pound brain. What you need to do is do what he said.
Yes.
Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out devils. That's all we got to do.
Come on.
And I'm not afraid to offend people if I feel like they've got a devil. Not all the time they're going, ah. When somebody's bound to something they can't get free from, I guarantee you there's a devil in there somewhere.
Amen.
Now, I don't know if it's in you, on you, or around you, but we're going to get rid of it, okay?
Right.
Next
right.
Page. Acts chapter 10:45. A lot of people want to know, well, maybe that's not my gift, that speaking in tongues or healing or whatever. I'm going to tell you something. Everybody look at me right now. You know what your gift is? The Holy Spirit.
Yes.
He's a person. And all of him comes to live inside of you when you get born again. And I'm just telling you right now that you don't have to sift through and go through some stupid gift analysis. Your gift is the Holy Spirit. And I guarantee you, he's got everything you need in there. Because you know what? What if somebody was in a bad car wreck and Sherry's got the gift of discernment, I've got the gift of tongues. You know what? That dude's going to die. Got to round up somebody with a gift of healing. I got the gift of healing. I don't even have to have a gift of healing. I've got a command from Jesus to heal. And so all I need to do is be obedient.
Yeah, come on.
The Holy Spirit has been poured out on the Gentiles. So you're talking about God messing you up. The Jews had it all figured out how it was going to happen. You got to have an experience with Jesus. Got to be water baptized. Filled with the Holy Spirit. That's it. And then Cornelius comes along. The Italians. Hey! And while Peter was talking to him, they got filled with the Holy Spirit. He said, wait a minute, you're all out of order. How many of you want God to mess up your order and just show you something ridiculously awesome, right?
Lord, yes.
Next thing. 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 6, I'm going to reiterate my thoughts, says there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of ministries, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of activities, but it is the same God. Watch this. Who works? Say it with me. All in all. That word, that Greek word, all, means all. Both places. So you don't have to worry about I'm not gifted in something. Why is it that more people will pray out loud in tongues than prophesy? Because when you pray out loud in tongues, there's not much responsibility.
Okay.
Right? When you prophesy, you got to get it right. You have to hear from God and say words that we understand. But they're both needed.
Okay.
They're both needed. And I'm just saying there's so many other things. He gave us 9 gifts of the Spirit, but that doesn't max him out by any means. He does all. He does all. So what we need to do is to experience all. It's kind of like, you know, if I go to Six Flags and drive all the way over there in the just the pelting heat. How much, there's $100 a ticket. And how stupid would me to get in there and go to the first thing in the merry-go-round, ride it once, and then go out and leave? How dumb would that be? The price is the same. Come on, baby. Ride all the rides. Because you won't need any of this when we get to heaven. So while we're here, just get in on all of it.
Come on, yes.
Next page. Why would I do that? Because Paul wrote through the Holy Spirit, pursue love and, say it with me,
desire spiritual gifts.
But especially that you may prophesy. Just by what Pastor Judy just said over the offering. You know, it doesn't cost you anything to go up and encourage somebody. It's like this. If you hear something in your head say, you know Mark Brandon back there? I'm going to tell him how awesome he is and how much God loves you and how much he has planned for you and how you've always been the apple of his eye. If I say that to Mark, what do you think Mark's going to feel like? Because I meant that, by the way. Kind of feels encouraging, right?
Yeah.
Heals some wounds, maybe. Well, there's only 3 possibilities of that. It's either just me. What's wrong with me encouraging him? Or it's the Holy Spirit. Or it's the devil. And then my question is, why would the devil want to encourage Mark?
Right.
So risk being wrong
right.
to be right.
Yes.
If you walked up to a blackjack table and I gave you 66.6666 odds of chance of winning, that's pretty good money. So I'm saying you just take a chance. Yeah, like I said, it doesn't have to be yay this and yay. Just say, hey, man, that's what I'm telling you. God wants me to tell you he really loves you today.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. Come on.
Right?
Right.
Some of you really hurt me. If I hurt you with that, I'm sorry. Go ahead and do that if you want to. It's exhausting to me to try to pretend that it's God's actual voice. Hey! How about me tell you? He's telling me, I'll tell you. I'll be the conduit here, okay?
Yeah.
I'll get all that Elizabethan English. I was one guy, someone, one Thanksgiving, we were up in Tennessee with Sherry's family. And this old boy was just country as cornbread. I mean, bib overalls was his tuxedo. And he just talked to you like this, and hey, that's it. But it came time to do the blessing, and here he goes, thee, thou, thine, God is thou, thee. And I'm thinking, who are you?
Right.
What is that?
Right.
I think we should talk the way we normally talk. I don't know, maybe it's me.
Come on.
If I was an unbeliever, I thought there was tongues. I don't know. 1 Corinthians 14, 24 through 25. It talks about the prophecy. Now, here's what I want to say to you. What is prophecy? The word of prophecy. It means you're either foretelling the future or you're telling it forth. You're preaching. You're saying it. Yeah. And so here's the thing about prophecy. Y'all, have I got you? Prophecy is the mold of what's possible.
Yeah. Okay.
God's showing you that this is possible. This is what I have planned for your life. Your choices are going to get you there.
Okay.
Right? Your application of your life to my promise is what's going to get you there. You just won't, you're not going to sit back and float down the lazy river and say, well, whatever the Lord wants. Yes. Well, he wants you to apply yourself. He wants you to ask him continually, what's my next step?
Yeah.
But here's one thing he said. Back in the church at Corinth was just like swinging from the ceiling fan. I mean, they were just like, I'm serious. They'd come to have communion, and they'd all just get drunk, eat the bread, and pass out.
Come on.
Paul said, hey, guys, listen, that's kind of not what this is for. Everybody's running around screaming in tongues. Everybody's prophesying to the top of their lungs, and nobody can even understand what you're saying. I'll give you an example of that. On the count of three, I want you to shout your name, your first name to me. One, two, three.
Jay!
Okay, do you understand any of that? Because it's chaos. And you said your name very plainly to be understood, but because there's so much going on. That's why he said, in the body,
yes.
One is a hand, you know, if I'm not the eye or the whatever. The reason he said that is when all individually, we're all individual bricks.
Yes.
Everything in me is Jesus. I've got the Holy Spirit. I got all the gifts. But when we come to assemble ourselves, as a body, he's not going to do the same thing twice. He's not going to do the same thing at the same time as everybody else. And one of the first churches we were at, there was Sister So-and-so, and every time at 10:43, she's going to be singing in tongues every Sunday. And I'm just saying, okay, that worked once. But you know what? He may use somebody else the next time. And after a while, it just got to where we're going, okay, here she comes. Watch out, boys. Okay. those of you old enough to remember that one, I'm sorry. But it's like what I started realizing is that if we're really following Jesus, he's just going to show up in different things. One man plants, another waters, but God gives increase. And it doesn't become a charismatic show. It just becomes the body alive, ministering to each other. Is anybody with me this morning?
Yes.
He said that prophecy is for one purpose. Tongues are for one purpose. Healing are for one purpose. So that an unbeliever or uninformed person comes in, he is convinced by all, he's convicted by all, and thus this, the secrets of his heart are revealed. And so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is truly among you. Why do we need all this stuff? For the unbelievers. Nan, if you're watching, I'm going to tell you your story. Sherry's mom was not in church and really had, she bought a bunch of books on, you know, philosophy and L. Ron Hubbard and all kinds of stuff. And so we decided we're going to ask her to church. So she came with her church father, James. And he's of a particular denomination that don't believe, nobody believes anything. And we're all going to hell except them. And I'll let you figure that out. And so they came to church and we got in the balcony. And the whole time I'm praying, oh God, please don't let Sister So-and-so do her time. Oh God, please don't let Sister So-and-so. And we got through and I thought, you know what? Right before the announcements, so I couldn't even look down the road to see their faces, what was going on. Message was great. The ministry was great. The praise and worship was awesome. And so we leave there and we go out to eat. What did Nana want to ask about? What was that woman doing? Quick lesson on tongues. And she said, when she started doing that, I started crying. So see, we think we got it all figured out. God knows what he's doing, but he needs some people to pop the top.
Okay.
and be willing to be used. Be willing to make be willing to make a fool of yourself.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because it's not about us anyway, right?
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Next page.
By the way, she got back in church. That prompted Mom to get back.
Got her back in church, and she got born again and filled with the Holy Spirit. Started a whole statewide recognized ministry to children called I Am for Kids, and just on and on and on. This is John 13, and this is one of the things that I'm going to get you out of time. I'm chasing stories from rabbits in my story. I felt like this. He's commanded us to be filled. Overflowing. It's a command, it's not a suggestion. Acts chapter 1, he said in verse number 4, he commanded them to not depart from Jerusalem, but be filled with the Spirit. Okay? But there, I find there's always some hesitance. And I'm going to touch on two things. Because I find that some people actually have enough integrity about them that they're not going to ask God to fill them because they're afraid they might fail him. And so they just kind of linger back because the devil's told them they're not worthy enough to be filled with the Spirit. They're not worthy enough to go and heal people. They're not worthy enough. That I've got so many skeletons in my closet that, you know, I'm like a graveyard. And so one of these people was Peter. You know, Peter, it's like a guy said, he's got one speed. It's 11. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, it kind of got him in some trouble when he cut the soldier's ear off. Jesus didn't want him to do that. You know? And here's Jesus telling him, he said, where I'm going, you can't follow me. But you'll follow me afterwards. And Peter said to him, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I'll lay down my life for your sake. And Jesus said, will you? Will you lay down your life for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me three times. What happened to Peter? I'll tell you what happened to Peter. He thought Jesus was going to storm into Jerusalem and take over the government. And all of a sudden, they're beating him with sticks and dragging him by the hair. And he suddenly, everything he knew just got washed away. And so people would ask him, say, man, you were with Noah. No, your speech betrays you. You sound like one of them. It wasn't me. So finally, the only way he could distance himself from being associated with Jesus is to cuss. And said, when Jesus was resurrected, he said, go tell my disciples and Peter to come. Peter felt so badly about his failure that he just didn't even see himself worthy enough to be a disciple. Little did he know, won't you listen to me? Little did he know that God's calling on his life, God's election on his life, the job that Jesus warned him to do, didn't go away because he messed up.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
Next page. And so after Jesus is resurrected, here's Peter sitting around with the disciples. The other 11. The other 10, actually. And he said, you know what? I'm going to go back fishing. I'm a good fisherman. I'm a terrible disciple. But at least I can make a living. Little did he know that the anointing on his life to be a leader, to be a pastor, didn't turn off because he had a bad day. Because when he said, I'm going fishing, the rest of them said, we're going with you. So they're out there fishing, and somebody comes up on the bank and says, hey, you got any food? And they said, we've been fishing all night, haven't caught anything. This sounds so familiar. And John leaned in on Peter and says, it's the Lord. At that point, Peter, it says, put on the garment that he had taken off to fish and jumped in the water. Why would anybody put clothes on to jump in the water? Why was he doing it? Because he didn't want Jesus to see him. Because the minute he heard the voice, he realized, I am not where I'm supposed to be. And so they came in, and he said, cast your net on the other side, and they pulled in such a multitude of fish that even though the net didn't break, there was 153 fish in there. I did some research on that. There's 153 different species of beings on earth. I just thought that was interesting. And so they're sitting around the campfire. You ever see City Slickers with Billy Crystal?
Yeah.
Okay, and he's sitting there playing the harmonica, and Jack Gillum says, stop that. I kind of got that picture as how they're sitting around the campfire eating their fish. Should we know him? Should we not know him? What are we supposed to do here? I don't know. And so finally, just Jesus turned to Peter and he said, Peter, do you love me more than those fish? Peter said, you know I love you. And then he asked him again. He said, well, if you love me, then I want you to feed my sheep. You know, like I told you. Like I've never stopped loving you. Like I've never given up on you.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
And he says again, Peter, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. He said, I want you to tend those sheep. And finally, one more time, he says, Lord, Jesus said to Peter, says, do you really love me? And Peter just kind of was flabbergasted. He didn't understand why he was getting grilled. He said, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, well, then I want you to feed my lambs. You know what just happened there? Jesus gave Peter an opportunity to restore himself. Because for every time he denied him, he said, here, tell me you love me. One more time. Okay, now that's gone forever. It will not shroud you from this day forward. It will not be part of who you are. It's under my blood, and it will never be brought up again. Do you understand me? Now let's get to work.
Yeah, amen.
That's
good.
I got one more. Next page. In the Jewish faith, there are lots of feast days. Please stay with me. This is important right here. This is the Feast of First Fruits because they would go out and harvest the very first barley that was grown, and they would wait, put it in a bundle, and hold it up to the Lord and wave it to him. It's like you bless this first fruit so we'll have a big crop. And then there's another feast day. One more. To where they take that same barley, they grind it up, and they make a loaf out of it. They put yeast in it. On Passover, they have a week-long festival where they go in and get all the yeast out of the house because it symbolizes sin. But on the day of Pentecost, they were to take that first fruit, they would grind it up and then mix it with sin and then let it rise into a loaf of bread. Now, why would he do that? Well, if Jesus was our first fruit, he was the firstborn among many brethren. He's the firstborn from the dead. Jesus, he paid an innocent, sinless price for us. So we're to come next. Listen to me. They took that barley and they ground it up and they put sin in it. And you know, if you put yeast in bread dough, if you leave it alone, it'll eat the whole thing. There won't be anything left except what the remains of the yeast. So how we're messed up. How do we do this? How can we stop the sin from spreading and devouring the host? It's simple. You put it in the fire. So many people come to me and say, and I can hear it in their voice, when I get perfect, then I'll get filled. You got it backwards, friend. You get filled, he'll make you perfect. You're bound stuff you're not even supposed to bound. You need to turn him loose in you. Let him go and watch what he's going to do to your life.
Yes, yes, yes.
Next page. Let's dim the lights for me. Moses had been in the wilderness for 40 years. Because he killed someone. And he was afraid. Fear banished him to a foreign land. And I'm going to ask you some questions. And you know what? If you don't want to comply, that's up to you. I feel like this is an ordained day where we start that revival. We start the fire burning uncontrollably in our lives and it catches everybody around us. That we don't just come to study the Bible so we can argue it, but that we let the Spirit of God transform us every time we come into this. We're already ready inside, but that's not doing anybody good. We got to be ready on the outside. That's the part they see. And Moses named his first child Geshem, which means God has divorced me. But he kept tending those sheep over right there around Mount Horeb, the mountain of God. 40 years waiting maybe to be restored, to be forgiven. He knew once he started growing up and hearing the stories about himself, he realized I was drawn from the water. I'm not really an Egyptian. If you knew me then, you believe me now. God sent him when he was 80 years old. How did he do that? Because as he was out there drawing near to God, a bush caught on fire, yet it wasn't consumed. You ever set one of those on fire? The flames shoot up. You know, this little glowing thing that Hollywood does. Man, it was a fire. And a voice came out of that bush. And he said, take your shoes off. For this ground is holy. Why take your shoes off? Because those shoes bear the marks of everywhere you've been in your life. The shoes back then were made by the person wearing them. So this is what you've made of you and where you've been. And when you're barefooted, you're more in touch with your steps. So if you'll put your foot right where mine just was, you'll know that you can trust that it won't get cut and messed up. And God said to Moses, I'm going to send you back in and you're going to fulfill your destiny. You're going to deliver my children. I've heard their cries. And Moses stuttered and said, how can I do that? What you got in your hand? A stick? Good, we're going to use the stick. And before he sent him out, listen to me. This is you right here. How will they know that it's you? What shall I say their name is, that your name is? You tell them that I am. That I am. And then he has him do a couple of things. He said, throw that rod on the ground and became a serpent. And said, then Moses picked it up by the tail. Who picks up a snake by the tail? Unless you've got complete authority over that snake. Put your hand inside your robe and pull it out. And when it did, it was leprous, white as snow. He said, put it back in. It came out like brand new flesh. Take that pot of water and fill it up with water and pour it out. And when he poured it out, it became blood. What was he telling Moses? I am the God that has all the authority. I'm the God who takes the leprous and makes them clean. And I'm the God that's going to show this world that water will never wash you clean. It's going to take the blood to wash you clean. I'm saying right now in this house, I feel like it's time for us to get baptized in the Holy Spirit if we're not, to get filled up if we have been, to where it's sloshing around out of us on everybody around us. Because this world is desperate to meet Jesus. And if we don't show him to them, if we don't show Jesus to them, they don't have a hope. They don't have a chance. Why don't you stand with me?